All right, so I guess I won't walk around. Normally I like to walk around because I think it's... Who wants to sit in a class and just watch someone drone on about programming, you know? Let's see, I will play this now. Yeah, oh, it's gonna be really hard. You might have to remind me to like not walk around too much. Right, so I'm Ben Marks. I am from the States. I'm here sort of by way of Europe. And I work for Magento. Here's my contact information. If you get nothing else out of this presentation, at least that will be something useful. What I like to do is I like to hear from people who are working with our system, because now that we have Magento 2 out, it's the developer feedback is it's actually essential to sort of adjusting in the early stage of release and making sure that we have something that people are happy to use, right? So we regularly get feedback from people. We regularly get feedback from the developers working with Magento. We are currently in a big process of making some updates to Magento 2, which was released last November. And that contact information is one of the ways to give us feedback. Was mentioned in the introduction, I started out in 2008 working with Magento 1, but working for an agency. I was just the very first employee of that agency, Blue Acorn. And Blue Acorn is now one of the preeminent Magento agencies in the world, I'm proud to say. So I was a developer there for years and eventually moved into director of development position. I also, at the same time, was doing some training for Magento U. So after a few years of Magento 1 being out, Magento kind of said, hey, we should probably offer education. And I was lucky enough to be one of the first two instructors for Magento U. The class that I was teaching mostly was the Fundamentals of Development. There's some videos online from that series. I've taught that, I think, about 40 times. It's about 40 weeks of my life that I spent in classrooms with developers. And now I serve as Magento's evangelist, which basically just means I'm going around and going to all the events and meeting wonderful people like you all. Speaking of which, how many of you are currently working with Magento? For the record, one hand has gone up. Okay. Wow. Okay. So everyone is brand new to Magento. That's always a challenge because so when Magento 1, Magento was just full of its own little interesting conventions, and when we made Magento 2, we really added some new conventions and we held on to some of the old. So I kind of have to speak, sometimes I have to speak a little differently if I'm speaking with someone who is brand new to Magento or someone who's kind of coming at Magento 2 from a Magento 1 perspective. Magento 1 is now in long-term support and will actually be, we will stop supporting it in 2018. These days, people are really starting to jump over to Magento 2. And the nice thing about that is that it's been Magento 2 is replacing an application that was created essentially in 2007, right? So if you think about where for Magento 1 context, if you think about where programming and e-commerce have gone since 2007 to now, that's why we had to come out with Magento 2. All right, I'm still actively resisting the urge to just jump up and walk around. Magento 2, snapshot, is open source, right? So the source is actually, we openly develop, we post that development on GitHub, and we interact with our huge worldwide community of developers. I don't know that we've quantified it, but you know, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of Magento developers, and it's a very rich community. You can go most places and find someone doing Magento stuff. So Magento comes in, well, it comes in three flavors, but two are something that you would download as an archive. We have our community edition, and then we have an enterprise edition, which is essentially the community edition plus more, right? Just plus some additional functionality in terms of like commercial features, as well as enhanced scalability, etc. We also have a platform as a service offering now called the Enterprise Cloud, and that actually does use the exact same Enterprise Edition code base, but we just handle all the infrastructure for you. Magento, you should know, is and this goes for Magento 1 and Magento 2. One of the most important things to understand right off the bat is that Magento is its own PHP MVC framework. That PHP MVC framework is used to build the commercial application. So in Magento 1, there's actually I think it's called like Magento Lite or Mage Lite or something, where someone actually took all of the e-commerce stuff out of the Magento package and just made it a general PHP MVC framework. Or what was left was a general PHP MVC framework. So that same script was followed for Magento 2. Although in Magento 2, it's much more elegant of a distinction, because we were able to use Composer and truly abstract the framework completely away from all of the commercial code. So as part of our updates for Magento 2, we string the entire system together with Composer. We follow PSRs 1, 2, 3, and 4, although you'll notice there is an asterisk on 2, and that's because we have some style violations. They're noted, I think, in the doc blocks. But and it's silly. It's just silly things like protected properties begin with an underscore, right? That's I don't think that's actually 100% proscribed by PSR2. But it's one of those things we'd like to change. But in order to change that, it's a breaking change, so we'll have to wait till a later date. Another thing to understand, by the way, this is like the only slide like this. Everything else is get down and get dirty. Another thing to understand is that there are two version numbers which apply to Magento 2. We have the marketing version, and that's where we say things. That's how we talk about Magento with merchants. We say, hey, Magento 2.2 features these awesome new abilities. Now, underneath, and in between those, you know, those marketing releases, we have regular updates to the framework, and there's a separate version that follows that actually obeys, follows semantic versioning. So if you're working with Composer, so if you're a PHP developer, you're working with Composer, essentially semantic versioning just has very specific rules about about how version numbers work. So essentially if you have a version number like 100.0.1, that's basically a patch level release for the major version 100. And if you have some kind of backwards incompatible change, you then have to increment that major number. And so what this does is this allows us to actually make some changes to the underlying framework that might be backwards incompatible, and not have to call it Magento 3, because our marketing department wouldn't be happy with that. Magento 2 is a big application. There is a lot of stuff going on. It's highly configured. There's a lot of explicit configuration, and there's a lot of sort of meta level work that the application's doing. So as a result, we have to heavily cache it for a lot of the e-commerce data. We have to index that, and we even actually include out of the box native full page cache via Varnish. And then we have an entire like UI component framework where if you're just updating a view with data, that actually is a pretty terse communication. And it just works because all you're exchanging with the server once the browser has downloaded the rendering, the templating code the first time, or templating markup, then communication between the browser and server after that point is just about the data. Magento 2, if you've heard about Magento 1, one of the complaints that I've been hearing like literally at every PHP conference since 2013 when I started going to PHP conferences, was that Magento is untestable. Why is it untestable? It uses a God class, et cetera, et cetera. And it's just because Magento was created in 2007 and not many people were testing their apps in PHP in 2007. Right. This class, or this tutorial, is woefully insufficient to turn you into someone who can walk in tomorrow into an office and get a job as a Magento developer. And that's just because there's a good bit to learn. I've seen really good developers. I've hired really good, especially Java developers, who can get acquainted with the framework conventions within a week and can really understand the Magento's commerce domain modeling and operations within a month. And I say Java particularly because Magento is definitely takes a lot of the pages out of the playbook of like Java, like a Spring. Any questions for that brief little introduction into Magento 2? Okay. All right. Who here has already installed Magento 2? Okay, that's one hand's gone up. All right, so I wanted to do this first so that if you want to try, I'm assuming Amazon, our awesome sponsors, I'm assuming Amazon has a decent connection here in the office. It can be a bit heavy to download, to get going. One of the best ways to get up and running, absolutely recommend it if you can, is by using Vagrant or Docker. If you want to install Magento 2, the basic way of doing this, you can just call Composer Create Project, and we actually host our own Satis instance with at repo.magento.com. And we do that because we have an extension marketplace. We actually have an app store that ties in your purchases with our repository. So that line right there will be enough to get you going. You can also, if you want to, you can also work with Magento just by cloning our repository. And I've got the basic, that's not a 100% correct command right there, but if you just go to GitHub, you can get the repo URL and clone it. That is actually what you want to do if you want to just kind of keep track of the latest changes. And if you want to contribute to our development, right? So we do accept pull requests. And all you have to do is when you do a pull request, you do it against the developer branch. However, the caveat there is if you're working with our developer branch, you have to understand that don't put that in production. It's developer, right? It's going to be unstable. And we do have tagged releases there that you can work with as well. We also offer a sample data package, and anyone who has been developing with Magento 1 could tell you that sample data was a little curious, for Magento 1. Magento 2, we actually have a nice little command line script. It's bin Magento, just bin relative to the application root. And it comes with a lot of commands. If you are doing modern PHP development, probably you have seen this kind of command line interface before. We use Symfony's excellent command line components for that. In fact, I'll There we go. I will show you. There we go. So here's if I just call bin Magento here. So I'm using a popular Vagrant image for this. Vagrant setup for this, And you can see there are a lot of commands. You don't need to actually be able to read these, but this is a nice extendable interface, right? So it's not just for our functionality. We build everything as modular as possible. And so it's possible, like if you want to create a module and your module has maybe some developer level stuff that it needs, that might need to be doing, you can provide very easily a command line interface option here. Okay. Let's see. And so one of those commands, the sample data, that'll allow you to actually deploy the application. Deploy sample data into your installation. And then all you have to do after you do that is just run the upgrade facility, and that will, what that does, for those of you who want to get started with Magento 2 development, is it pre-populates a ton of data. So Magento has a massive number of tables, and just putting in data to make the application look, like a working store. It can be actually take quite a while to mock up, the products and customers and orders and all these things. And sample data does that for you. So it's a really great way just to have a local working installation that you can then develop against and kind of with a feel for what this looks like in a production environment. All right. Here. All right. Now, so for your development preparation, there are people who are just have a fantastic Vim setup. There are people with fantastic Emacs setup. Although those people are always weird. I'm sorry. I hired one of them. He was great, but man, he was it's Emacs, you know. But you have to have a setup that allows you to navigate the code quickly, and I have to say, for PHP development these days, especially for Magento development, PHP Storm is highly recommended, because, well, for one, for the as a product, PHP Storm, JetBrains really, they release fast and furious, right? So they are constantly updating that offering. It kind of puts everything at your fingertips. A lot of the tasks that you need to do are as simple, usually, as like Alt Enter, and the IDE just kind of knows what you need to do by context. Refactoring tools, lots of other tools are there for you if you're using something like PHP Storm. And then, of course, a good step debugger. Everyone here, who uses a step debugger regularly in PHP development? Only a hand. So, I'll do a little demo and show you how it works, because it's awesome. And when you think about an application like Magento that's got, I don't know, a million lines of code or whatever, like, you need to be able, that's a really deep call stack, right? So you need to be able to jump through and find out what's going on. And in our current state with Magento 2, I will say there are a few places where you get these wonderful exceptions, like invalid file, which doesn't really help you when there are thousands of files. When you are creating your installation, let's see how I want to do this. When you're thinking about a working setup, I'll suggest that there are a few options at your disposal. Our community, which I mentioned earlier, is fantastic. The open source spirit, if you're not aware, the open source spirit is it is realized profoundly in the Magento world. So what you'll find is you will find some of the biggest agencies putting some of the stuff that they have spent, hundreds of hours developing internal tools, they'll put that online. And they will share it for free, MIT license, with the rest of the world. And just simply because that's how it is. The number of hackathons that I get to attend that are organized by our community, amazing. There is an entire business, a nonprofit in Germany, that we now partner with, They put on 25 events this year. So I'm in Jakarta next week. The end of this week. Yeah, next week. I'm in Jakarta next week, attending a conference that someone has organized. And it's called Meet Magento Indonesia, right? We don't organize those. Someone else does. I just show up. That's the kind of community that we have. And in that spirit, a lot of people have figured out a great way for you to get going using Vagrant, using Docker. If you want, actually, I can recommend. Let's see here. The instance that I'm using right now, it's actually tracking a little bit behind because it's like 2.0.4, I think, is Mage2 Vagrant. So if I do, there we go. So this one right here, the README is all you need to get going, and all you have to do is just set up Vagrant in your, you know, download, install Vagrant, and then a couple of commands, and you're up and running. And the nice thing is, especially if you're doing work, if you have clients and they're on like PHP 5, whatever. For Magento 2, you really should be running PHP 7. Magento 2 was made for it, and the speed benefits help a lot during development. So that is, if you want to try and follow along in this class, if I don't know how quickly you can get this set up, but this would be the way I would recommend. Mage Inferno, Inferno. They have Docker images, on Docker's hub. So you have an Nginx setup is probably the one to go to there. All right. Now, an important developer preparation is to use the command line tool. And check the mode that Magento is running in. So Magento as an application has three modes: default, production, and developer. Production is the mode that your Magento instance is in, wherever it is running, serving your customers. And production assumes that everything has been, all the static assets have been deployed, that, you know, a lot of, that all the caches have been generated, et cetera, et cetera. Default mode means that you didn't choose one or the other. And that's actually not ideal. Default kind of tries to figure out what you're doing and what's going on. Developer mode allows you as a developer to visualize changes and get error messages that you wouldn't otherwise get. Basically, Magento in production mode will suppress error messages as best as it can. And that is, as you know, I think one of the great things about PHP is it's a very friendly language. It's, hey, by the way, I believe on line 5 you forgot a semicolon. Not like a, you know, null pointer exception or something from Java. When you're not getting that immediate feedback when you are refreshing your browser, when you're developing and all you see is like a white screen of death or just something that says, hey, something went wrong, but I'm not going to tell you what, that doesn't help you as a developer. So enabling developer mode is fairly essential. Since I can't get up and point, and I feel it's very important to point, I will use my laser technology. There we go. All right. So the commands that you can run. So you can check the running mode of Magento. Deploy mode show. And actually, the command line tool, again, one of the benefits of using other people's work, this is what makes like Composer and the efforts of the FIG, PSRs, everything, makes it so great when you can just pull in someone else's work and benefit from it. So you get things like, abbreviated syntax. So this DM set is short for deploy mode set. And it just does a string match to find out if a command is unique. And then, so the couple things that you want to do when you're getting into developer, when you're getting into Magento development, is make sure that you set developer mode, and that you disable the configuration cache, because as we'll see in just a moment, Magento really, really likes for you to be. I'm sorry, Magento is caching that configuration, and a lot of the work that you do as a developer is just changing XML, right, in Magento. And then you can even you can also just if you prefer, you can just keep flushing the cache after you make a change. But I can't tell you the amount of hours that have been lost for developers for, like, you know, sitting there and refreshing, like, why isn't it working? I forgot to clear the cache. Right, so my changes just weren't being picked up by the application, and disabling. There are multiple cache types in Magento. So, wish I could present this in a window. Maybe I can. Anyway, let's see. So if I do this, whoops. So I do bin Magento. And then I don't remember the command, so I'll say cache, and it's something like that. And I'll get this suggestion list here. I can even make this bigger here. Do that. Oops. There we go. All right. So I get a list of possible matches. So I can I could maybe run cache status. And I can see here are my cache types, right? Okay, the green laser may not be as helpful here. So you can tell I've already turned off my configuration cache and my layout cache. And then there's all these other cache types here. And in general, I've also turned off full page cache. So in general, what you want to do as a Magento developer is you want to leave as many caches enabled as possible while you're developing. That keeps things moving quickly. But if you're going to be constantly changing at one area, you probably just want to disable that cache. Otherwise, you have to remember to clear that out every time. Let's see. Oh, by the way, if you have any questions as I'm going along, absolutely happy to make this interactive. In fact, I prefer it, just so I don't feel like I'm alone up here behind the cameras. All right. Let's see. Well, this is an interesting. I was hoping everyone would have Magento installed and we'd be walking along coding together. So I will just walk through the stuff that I've done and try and tell you interesting and amusing anecdotes along the way. All right. So at this point, what I've tried to explain is, how as a developer you get going with Magento 2, right? So first you've got to get it installed. However, one of the great strategies for managing Magento installations is to use something like Vagrant or Docker, especially when other people are keeping it up to date, right? Now, of course, if you are working on a client site, you will probably want to manage your own instances, and you will come up with various strategies for how you keep your custom code, stored and separate from the Magento core. There's all sorts of strategies out there. There's some really, really good articles that you can check out. And I'll write up a few, especially if I get some questions at the end, so that you can have a reference of who to go to. All right, let's see. All right. Who is familiar with dependency injection? Anyone? Just hands. Who here is too shy to raise their hand? This is my results are getting skewed. It's okay, you're definitely more outgoing than, like, let me see, when I speak in France. Oh my gosh. It's like pulling teeth. All right, so dependency injection. Wow. hadn't even occurred to me. Dependency injection is a strategy for decoupling code. It is not foolproof, right? You can build some really terrible stuff with dependency injection. You can end up coupling yourself regardless. And there are lots of debates about, you know, what's the best way to do it. And some practices are outright bad. Some kind of depend on how the implementation is done. So the way this works in Magento, there's two levels to our dependency injection. So what the strategies that we use is we use constructor injection. So I guess I'll start with a kind of a counterexample. In Magento 1, let's say I have a block. Now this is a PHP class that has some logic for displaying information about some entity, and we'll say that entity is what's a good entity to use there. There's a good entity to use there. All right, this is a hypothetical example because it's not quite this straightforward in Magento, but let's say I have a PHP class, and that PHP class is used with a template, and it needs some product data, right? Because it's got to. I'll take the recently viewed products collection, right? So if you're on a Magento site, and by the way, I should mention, marketing would be very disappointed with me if I didn't. Like the Magento world is very big in terms of the business and the impact. It's open source. So we don't know how much money exactly flows through Magento code, but the kind of conservative estimate that we have from the market analysts is $50 billion a year in commercial volume goes through Magento code base. And you've got over 150,000 transacting stores out there. And then already a couple thousand Magento 2 stores spun up. So that is basically, I just wanted to use that as my introduction for saying, like, the number of times I've actually gone to buy something when I wasn't buying it off of Amazon, which I can say now that we're no longer part of eBay. eBay sold us, so now we're owned by private equity. So when I'm not buying something on Amazon, I will be checking out, buying something online. I'm like, shit, that's Magento's site. Like, see all this. I know this stuff. I also know some hacks, so I can usually get everything for free. Just kidding. That would be bad. if you are on a Magento site, or even on, I guess, any other lesser commercial application site, as you're browsing through things, you may see something pop up, you know, as you go from page to page to page that has, a list of the most recent products that you've viewed. That is a recently viewed products block. The way view modeling works in Magento is you have an XML file that says, hey, on this page or on all pages in the left column, maybe after some other blocks of content, you have the recently viewed products block. And that XML directive just takes, identifies a PHP class and identifies a template most of the time. And those two, essentially a common block method, is run, pulls in the template, echoes into a buffer, shoots the content out at you. It's very simple. It's a little bit different from sort of the classical MVC modeling. It's more of a view model approach. So that recently viewed products collection, I really wish I had a whiteboard to draw on that was on camera, but it's not. I'm gonna go off script here. Sorry.
Do we have a permanent marker I can use?
Do we have markers here? That is definitely a number of times I've gone into training centers and you pull down the screen and you can see like someone wrote on it. So one of the things that I like to do here. Oh, Lambda, I see we're talking about Amazon. All right. I'll do a quick little diagram for you because this is essential. This applies to Magento 1 and also to Magento 2 in sort of the basic level. You have a block class, and that's just a PHP class. And then we use templates, makes sense. And these are just PHTML, right? So combination of PHP and HTML. In Magento 1, sometimes these PHTMLs would get really, really complicated. And in general, you want all of the real logic-y stuff to be in your class, right? You don't want a whole lot of switches and stuff and templates. But I will tell you, the Magento 1, some of the templates are just the price template, the thing that is literally responsible for displaying, just like, you know, $3.98. That template is 400 lines long of HTML and PHP because it's all these conditionals. Because you have to check, well, okay, do you want to display just the regular price? What if you have a special price? Now, do you need to display this with with tax included, or do you need to display the tax separate, or do you need to include any of these other kinds of things? So they were really complex in Magento 1. Magento 2, we've done a lot of work to refactor those, basically that push that logic up into the PHP world where it belongs. But so imagine you just have a PHP class, and that class includes this template and just echoes into a buffer. All right. So, and again, these things were married, were called into scope, and married together, usually via XML. And that is Magento's famous layout XML. That is also a page straight out of the Java book. And it can be very confusing. I hated layout XML for like the first 2 years of Magento development. And then you start to get it. And then you realize that like you can do things. Like if your boss says, hey, I want recently viewed products to show up on the customer account page. Literally like one line of XML and it's done. And the great thing is that actually saves you from having to go into a controller and invoke the collection and pass the collection to the templates and all that stuff. So it's really nice. Now, in Magento 1, you might have your block class, and I'll just use a very poor example and just say I've got my block class here, and it needs a model instance, right? So you would say you might have a public function, get product, right? And we'll pretend that this is not how it works in Magento, but we'll pretend that it gets some ID. And then internally it just does, let's see. Back then we had this God class. That was really, this is kind of a bear to test for hopefully obvious reasons. Mage. Geez, it's been a while since I've done M1 development. It's actually mage get model, right? And then that would take a string argument to identify the class, catalog, product. And load ID. And then, of course, actually, this would be returned here. Okay. Don't worry if you can't read it. Doesn't work like that anyway. But this is the gist of it. So what you're doing here, so there's a couple things that are less than ideal. Of course, this God class thing. Kind of it really complicates testing. It also binds things into... It kind of binds things into a big messy scope, right? It's just a big object that kind of couples the whole application together. The other thing that's happening is you now have a direct dependency between this class and this thing here. And that's not ideal, right? That's not ideal at all. Because, well, I mean, we know dependencies are bad. Why do we know dependencies are bad? We don't really, I mean, they're not necessarily, you know, people don't die usually because of dependencies, but what it does is it makes extending the system, it makes changing the system more complicated. So better yet, the way we do it in Magento 2 is very blue hands for the rest of the day. We just do a little constructor magic, public function, struct, and then we would say something like product, and then in here we would actually set the instance. So it's a subtle difference, right? But the thing is, this is somehow receiving a product instance when it's being created, and that's the second layer of Magento 2's dependency injection structure. Is, as you can see here, this class here, the block class, is getting the objects that it needs via an object manager. I'll come back over here. All right. So this object manager. So there's this entire meta environment that is operating, that's grabbing, that's looking at all these class definitions and then looking at some XML arguments and checking, like, hey, are we really getting this class? Or maybe there's another class. You can actually configure that in Magento 2. The nice thing here is that the object manager handles and optimizes the loading of all this stuff in any dependent objects, et cetera, et cetera. It's a really big thing if you want to dig into it, and there are some people in the community who have. Alan Storm is one of them, and if you've been doing any Magento development, you know his name, and you always treat it with proper respect. But the gist of it is, all you have to do when you look at this, when you're getting started, is just realize that there is a system inside Magento 2 that just looks at these type hints, looks at some configuration, and then figures out what needs to be there and just handles that for you automatically. And that becomes part of the testing setup. This also is one of the ways to affect customizations. All right. I knew on the one hand I was thankful because I was getting late last night. I was thankful for the after lunch spot, but it's always dangerous to do the after lunch spot. I know. I could tell whenever I would teach that week long class, and like one day invariably the training centers would get pizza. Everyone would drop like flies afterwards. So you're doing a good job staying with me so far. And this is what that XML looks like, by the way. So in a module you can have di.xml. And di.xml just simply says, hey, when you need this, maybe that type hint, that type hint is actually should match up over here for something. You can also, when a constructor has, I don't remember if this one has arguments or not. Yeah, so at the end here, array, data. You can actually literally pass in, you could specify, hey, here are the arguments I want to pass in. So you can kind of configure those parameters via XML. I've seen a lot of good, you know, very pure, sort of pure PHP programmers get really put out by this whole mechanism. But you have to understand, like, Magento is built, it works out of the box, so you can download it, put in the sample data or not. I mean, and then you've got a functioning store, and all you may have to do is add some configuration just to make it work for a merchant. But yeah, you know, one of the things that you know, if anyone here is doing commercial development or, you know, development on commerce sites, it's always custom. Like, there is always custom requirement. And those customizations can get pretty deep and pretty wide across the system. So what we do is we build a system that has a lot of configuration options, just via the admin, but then we also have to build in a lot of configurability at the programmatic level. And one of the strategies that we use to manage that are these files, all these XML files, and there can be a lot. One of the things that we did do for Magento 2 is we added schema definitions. These are actual XML documents which describe what is allowable, basically what is valid for the purpose of this document. And that actually is helpful because tool like PHP Storm will actually, and you'll see an example of this later, PHP Storm can actually look at these schema definitions and as you're actually typing up, if you're creating some of this XML by hand, will actually give you the right options or tell you if you have a syntax error. And that also, so XML errors in Magento 1 are another huge cause of this, of just sort of nebulous waste of time. Because if you have a typo, if you have syntactically valid, structurally valid, but invalid syntax for the purpose of the document, in Magento 1, you don't get an error message because all it does is just say, hey, is this well formed? Doesn't have anything to compare it against and say, oh, wait, that value shouldn't even be there. There shouldn't be anything at that hierarchy or at that level. So we have this for Magento 2. So that's my quick little note on DI. And it's, I struggled with what to bring out in this tutorial because, again, there's so much to cover. But I think this is one of those things that you just have to be aware of, because I'll be the first to say when I opened up Magento 2 for the first time to really start working with it, and I saw, I saw all this constructor injection, and I saw, oh my God, all this stuff in the DI.xml. I'm like, wow, what is that? But that's all there is to it. It's just a strategy and an architecture for allowing the system to be customized. I don't actually cover the customization possibilities in here. I will probably do a little off the cuff thing on them. There are some really neat options. Magento, I'll go ahead and mention them now, right? So that's it for dependency injection. Again, very high level introduction. It's a big deep architecture. There are some great articles about it out there, if you want to follow up and kind of get into it. There are a couple of ways in Magento 2 that you customize the system at a programmatic level. We have events. Right, so Magento 1 also has events. And this is just literally a line of code that executes. If someone adds a product to the cart, there is an event that fires that says, hey, basically a catalog, product add to cart after. Right, and what that means is that is essentially as the execution stack has gone down really, really deep. Like you've hit the entry point, you've gone through the controller, basically the request has come in, to add a product to the cart, and you're way down deep in this call stack. Well, off to the side here, you just got this thing that essentially can raise a flag to this system that's just watching the whole thing run, and says, hey, product was just added to the cart. And here, let me give you a couple of contextually important objects. I'll give you that cart object. I'll give you that product object so you can do something with that. You can consume that with something called an observer, right? So you have events and you have observers. If you've done Drupal, it's similar to hooks. Again, just a very simple way of just sort of throwing up to a kind of a global scope and say, hey, this is happening, and here's the context. So that's in Magento 1. It's also in Magento 2. In Magento 2, we have this interesting thing called interception. Now, this is the most, this is the preferred way, when you can use it, of doing customization. What Magento 2 does is allows you to declare. Actually, you know what? I think I have an example in another. I was speaking at a conference in Germany 2 days ago, and I think I have an example here. Yeah, interception. So we'll play this really fast. We have these things called plugins, and plugins are our implementation of this interception pattern. So what you can do is you can say, like, hey, for this object here, the layer object. So this is the thing actually that when you go into a catalog, like say you're looking at a shirts category, and you want to just see like black shirts, or you just want to see shirts of a certain size, and you've got a little filter you can use. That's what a layer is in Magento. So for this thing, I need to add stock status on prepare front collection. So basically, I'm adding the stock status. So in Magento, the module, the catalog module, is responsible for products. And there is a separate module, catalog inventory, responsible for tracking stock status. The reason for that is that you can actually disable inventory tracking if you don't need it. And that whole module just doesn't do anything. And it can do that without breaking the system. So when it is enabled, basically it needs a way to add stock status to that collection of products that satisfy this filters. Well, so what you're saying here is, okay, for, let's see, Magento catalog inventory model plugin layer. So basically what's happened is we've defined a layer. So we've defined a class that is going to, whenever this class here, Magento Catalog Model Layer, prepare product collection, when that method runs, the system will actually invoke this class here and execute this code here before that method. Make sense? Think of like an onion skin, right? So essentially every public method in Magento 2, literally every public method in Magento 2 modules, is a hookable event, for lack of a better term. Right, so that means that when this method executes, Magento catalog model layer, prepare product collection, This interception architecture will look and see, like, hey, is there anything, are there any plugins defined for this? And the way the plugin conventions work is you just prepend before, after, or around the original method name and gets that code to execute. So if you're a developer of commercial systems and you think, hey, that's the most amazing thing ever, like, that's okay. That's a great reaction to have. If you're a developer and you say, that is the scariest thing ever, that's also a very correct response. Because we know from experience that if you give a developer any kind of tool, they will figure out a way to use it the wrong way. So is there, it's an important tool in your tool set. It gives you a kind of unparalleled access across the system. But it can also ruin your world. So imagine, there's one of the things that happened in the Magento 1 days is a lot of times we did this at Blue Acorn. We would take over sites that someone else had implemented less than optimally, right? And you have to find all the stuff that they did. And this gives people a whole new way to screw things up. But if you're a good developer, you can use this to do some amazing things. And you can do it. The nice thing is you're doing this in a very extendable way. This system can be upgraded. And you've essentially, I can change what happens when stock status is being added to the product information. I can get into that. And actually, what this is here, this is actually an example of the Magento application itself doing it. So Magento actually uses its own extensibility tools, both events and plugins, just in its core operations. So that architecture doesn't exist just for third-party developers. This actually is part of how Magento functions internally. So you can do really cool things, and you can define multiple plugins for the same methods. Right. So that's just a demonstration. It's one of the things that we have with Magento is you know, an extreme need for customization and all sorts of arbitrary customization. But people have to be able to upgrade. They absolutely have to be able to upgrade because we're building new features regularly, and if they can't upgrade, they can't avail themselves of those new features. All right, so those are that's just a quick little tour of Magento's extensibility features. And you can spend some time working on this. I will just say one more thing about this, because it's another important thing to understand. Can you imagine the application as it's executing, and it's executing hundreds, maybe thousands of public methods, how absolutely non-performant that would be if the application has to say, wait, oh, no, public method, let me go check the configuration, see if there's a plugin. Oh, there are some plugins, let me fire off those plugins. Okay, now let me continue with the stack, or continue down the stack. Yes, you're right. You didn't know I was a mind reader, but you're right. We actually, because we just really love cool architectures, we took a page out of the aspect-oriented programming playbook, and we have a system that will, when you go into, so essentially when you're in, well, sometimes when you're developing, well, in general, so what we do is we actually take your dependency injection configuration like this, and we take these class definitions, and we can actually materialize whole new versions of your class. So you will actually see we have in our transient folder var, you will actually see a generation thing here. Let's see. I have it here. In fact, we can see I created a custom controller for this tutorial. I created a simple little module. And the system has calculated that something else is consuming an event that's part of my controller. So the dispatch event here is being plugged in, right? This is how, by building my module according to Magento conventions, my controller is essentially having plugins executed for it, right? And there are, if I go into Magento here, I can find all sorts of other things. In fact, if I go and look at layer, what was this one? Yeah. I can see the effects of that dependency injection configuration right here. Like literally, this is materialized out of kind of out of thin air, because we have a plugin configured. So this is important stuff for Magento 2 to be able to function with any kind of efficiency. Okay, that's a deep dive. If I had more time, I would say let's take a break. But I'd say it's model time. Module time. Kind of a joke. When most of our development staff is Ukrainian, and they're all fantastic and wickedly smart people, but it's really tough to like have a conversation about like modules and models with them because of obviously really tough if you speak Slavic language to then have good pronunciation in one of the romantic languages or English. All right. Magento module structure. So if you have a module in Magento 2, it's literally, it's just a folder. You follow PSR naming conventions. And so this is just an example of the contact module. So in Magento 2 site, if you click on a contact us link and you get a little form, you fill it out and it emails somebody when it's submitted, that's what this is. Now, view. Some of the view stuff is here. All of your PHP, your class logic for presentation, that's going in here, the block. Controller, obviously, is going to house your controller files, and maybe some abstract base for those files, if you like. And then helpers, we have, because we converted Magento 1 from Magento 2. We converted Magento 2 from Magento 1. And so there's still some of the old architecture, some of the old stuff in there. Helpers are just sort of like, I am developing, I don't know where the hell to put this, I'm just going to bang it into a helper, and there it is. It's probably awful commingled stuff, but whatever. Great utility, hard later when you need to do a couple things. Helpers were notorious for like, oh, let me see. Well, I don't use newsletters. I don't use Magento's newsletter system. I'll just disable that. Boom, people can't check out. Like, the hell? Actually, I don't know for sure if that's a helper, but a great example of helpers often just contain stuff where people don't know where else to put it. So helpers should be eliminated over time in Magento 2 as we kind of go through and refactor the areas. Internationalization, so Magento comes natively with the ability to provide translations via CSV files. It's a bit limited, unfortunately, because in our world we use English tokens, English as tokens, which is okay as long as you're speaking English. So it gets a little tricky when you have things like the word order, because like order can apply to like a sort order, or order can apply to an order, or you can have someone order something. And all three of these things, it's okay to translate them similarly, but only in English, right? As you go to a different language, it's just different words. One of the things we'll be addressing actually very soon as well. Model is, of course, for your domain and kind of the crossover to your data access objects. Tests, so you would have unit tests under your module structure. And then there's actually a separate place to where you can put your integration tests and functional tests. And then view is where you contain layout XML, things like layout XML and your PHTML templates. All right? Now, one of the things that I like to do when I'm teaching people new to Magento, when I'm teaching them Magento, is just say, okay, so what is like the most basic module that you can have? Like what is the minimum that you need to do in order to really like have an effect on the system? And really it is a namespace, which you don't see here, a namespace, a module name, registration.php, which I'll show you in just a second, and then under etc, this is where all your XML configuration stuff goes. Everything except for layout XML, that goes under the view. So a registration.php, and then under etc, module.xml. Module registration. So I, being the wise marketer that I am using the absolutely inventive namespace of Ben Marks and Ben Marks brands. All right, so this is a brand module. Ideally, it will display a list of brands, or it will do things related to brands. We'll see how far we get. All right, again, the ability to not get up and just jump in front of this is killing me here. Right, so etc module.xml, it's very simple in structure. One of the things to get prepared for is we have all of our schema definitions referenced via, and I can never remember what URN stands for, universal resource something. Anyway, there's a thing called Google that will explain that immediately. What we have here, so this is just boilerplate. So every single module.xml will look basically like this. Now, it may have more information in it. There are other things that this file can do, can actually set a load order of configurations based on other modules. But the two essential pieces of information here are my module name. So this will become a unique handle that the system is used and using internally in some places. And that is just my namespace plus my module name, as well as a setup version. So you use a setup version to inform the system like, hey, I have migration scripts. Essentially, I need to have some effect. This module being in the file system also has a requirement of the database to have some schema available or some data available. And I do have an example of that later on. So the combination of putting these two files into the system, right? And I'm under, now, in this case, I'm operating under app code. I might explain that in a bit. Because I didn't really explain it before. Right, so registration.php, this is a shortcut that we came up with to reduce overhead. It's essentially is a file that the application can look for to see if a module exists at that point in the file system or not. And it's a pretty consistent syntax as well. It's fairly boilerplate. The only thing that you need in here really is your module handle, Benmark's brands. Now, if we go over to here, there are different component types that you can register. But essentially, let's pretend that I were making a scaffolding tool, and there are several which exist. But if I were making a scaffolding tool, I could, or even if I just wanted to increase my development speed and I like to type stuff by hand, I could very easily create a live template in PHP Storm that would just let me fill in this handle, this handle, and a setup version. So one of the things about Magento, one of the complaints I hear is just like, oh my gosh, it's so much to type, so much XML to type, so much, you know, boilerplate stuff. I'm like, it's the whole idea. It's like all that boilerplate just means that you write a script, you write a tool to help you with that. Because literally, if I want to create, initialize a new module, I really have to answer two questions. Like, what is the module namespace and name? And what is the setup version? And that script or utility or whatever can create that. And there already are multiple scaffolding scripts for Magento 2. All right, so this is the minimum module in Magento 2. It doesn't do anything, but this actually will have an effect on the system. Okay? Now, if you give me just a second, so I think it's going to make the most sense if I it'll make the most sense if I do some stuff here. Let's see. All right. Oops. All right. So I'd like to walk. So I think one of the things that I like to do as a developer evangelist is get people going, like get you feeling good about development. So let me see. Let me drop table. Okay, good. Now let me. Okay, all right. So I'm going to try and step through this like I'm developing live in front of you. I'm not really developing live since I've already got this stuff built, because developing live is a scary business in front of a class. When you're working with the system, as a developer, so let's say I want to get going. So I need to create a folder or a couple folders, and sort of tell the system, hey, here's a whole new area where you need to pay attention to what I'm doing. So one of the first things that I'm going to do is I'm going to disable the caches. Right, so I'm going to run the command here because I know I'm going to be developing like for today, and I'm going to be doing some stuff with routes, and I don't want to, you know, I'm going to probably make some mistakes and have some errors, and so I will just disable these two caches. So I just run the command cache disable and pass the two caches that I want to disable, config and full page. And so if I do this now, it actually won't have much of an effect because right now they're already. So I could actually run, you know, cache enable, but essentially just bin Magento cache disable. Again, you can abbreviate as much as you think is possible. Config and full underscore page, and it's not going to change anything because those two are already disabled, right? And the app, and actually the nice thing is you get this little message back that says there's nothing to change because those are already, you know, config and full page cache are already disabled. All right, so that's a good, important first step. Again, I'm going to be developing for a little while today, I don't want to have to go in and manually delete that cache. By the way, another way of deleting cache is just, it's a very scientific operation of going into the var folder under the application root and deleting cache. You can delete anything under var by implementation. Anything under var is transient, and the nice thing about being in developer mode is very often the application will sort of regenerate things that need to be regenerated for you if they're configured for it, or in the case where the system actually has to go through the dependency injection compilation, will actually say, hey, you need to run compilation here. So right now, as far as as far as my module is concerned, let's see, what's a fun way to do this here? Save myself some typing. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm actually going to There we go. All right. I think things won't blow up. So what I've done is I've essentially said, hey, I'm declaring my namespace. And by the way, if you do this and you want to get into Magento 2 development, and I have friends in the Magento business who have literally built multi-million-dollar extension companies, just identifying customer need and being the first to implement stuff. So it's worth the consideration, but you register your namespace with like packages, and away you go. So my namespace, Ben Marks. I'm gonna create a new folder here. I'm just gonna create a new file. So let's see, what's that new file gonna be? It's going to be, it's Ben Marks brands. It's gonna be my my module name, and then registration. .php. And the cool thing about PHP Storm is it understands that, like, I was typing in a directory tree. So I have this file here. And then what I want to do. I want to open. We'll see if that worked. Dev Vagrant Data. Ben Marks Brands, there we go. Okay. All right. Okay. And this will just save me from having to type. But actually, what I'm doing here is nothing. It's not that different from what you should do as a Magento developer. Like, when you're getting going, again, we have tools. There are tools out there that can help you scaffold all this stuff. But absolutely, the first couple of modules that you build, you should type this stuff by hand. Because what's going to happen is you're going to have typos. You're going to put things in the wrong place. And you absolutely will learn a little bit from that. But that's critical. That learning is necessary to be effective down the road when you have to work on teams with other people or work on a site that someone else has already worked on or even just deal with someone else's extension. So what I have here is my registration.php content. And let's see. So I'm going to copy that into here. So what I would do if I were developing from scratch and I didn't have my own module as a reference is I would just look up I would find another registration file and copy it and just change the relevant string, which in this case is just this tiny little bit right here. So I don't know how well you can see that. Right? And here's something that's interesting now. If I go and I execute. I'll do that down so you can see it in the light. If I do bin Magento, if I spell right, I spell good. Okay, and then I do, module status. I think that's the command. No. Oh, I may actually have to delete some stuff. And so, sidebar. Oh, I can't stand it. This is one of those things where I see what's happening. So bin Magento as a script will give you some cryptic errors. So like you saw when I was trying to just run this command, it's just like, hey, there's no commands defined in the module namespace. I'm like, yeah, there are. I know there's a whole set of module commands. That's how you work with the modules. But this is the error I get. So this is one of those things where we are. So we're actually in an actively working on platform level stuff for the next month or two. And so we're taking and our big focus there is actually developer experience. Right, because there are places where you get cryptic error messages like this. This isn't helpful at all. So this is one of those things where we do like to hear people's input, and you can file issues on GitHub. You can yell at me on Twitter. You can yell at me in my email, and that helps us prioritize what we fix. One of the things that you can do though when you're working with bin Magento and it's giving you cryptic stuff like this is you can just actually run bin Magento itself, which normally should give you a list. But in this case, it actually gives you a little bit more verbose output. So it's like, hey, something happened. Probably just try clearing out these caches because those caches are referring to something that doesn't exist anymore or something's changed. And you have a sort of less helpful error message here. But then I do actually have something here that does give me a little bit more help. And you can see the verbosity of output between trying to issue a command and then just trying to get the list is quite different. So down here I can see app code, bin marks, brands, etc. File get contents, it's not there. So that's a problem. So in this case, you know what? I probably need a new file. And that new file is my module file, which kind of the two of these together, again, are what help register my module with the application. So I'm just going to copy this, from my I really wish development worked this way, where you're like, oh, I need this, and it's just there. Maybe for Magento 3 we'll do that. And again, very simple file. All I'm doing is I'm declaring a name and a version number. And now let's see if this is enough. It may not be. By the way, breaking things is just that's standard operating procedure as a Magento developer. So don't ever get put out by exceptions. So that works. So now I have, I mean, basically by works, it means that I'm not breaking the system. And I can't tell you, as someone who went through the early days of, so back in the days of Magento 1, there was no documentation. It was a startup effort, basically, and they're just, you know how it is as a developer. You'll write the documentation later. It's the biggest lie developers ever tell themselves. Magento 2, what we did, so of course we started building Magento 2 when we were part of eBay. You know, eBay really helped fund the development of Magento 2. We also hired technical writers, which we found was like, it was like you're 100% more likely to write documentation if you have people on staff whose job it is to write documentation. Also, like, developers were more or less required to explain what they were doing to these people. Our documentation, by the way, is also on GitHub. So we accept pull requests, and all of our documentation pages have an edit this page link, so you can contribute to them as well. All right, so I'm not breaking the system anymore. That's good. That's happy. But like in the early days of Magento 1, like, it was, I can't tell you, I've never had a system where I was more happy to break it, because at least I knew I was working in the right area. So cool. That means that it's picking up my module. It's probably getting merged in here. So now I can do something. Let's see. Back to my presentation. All right. So it looks like I could run module status, and I can see if my module is actually listed there. Oops. There we go. Back here. Move this up, and I'll move this down a little bit so it's out of the light there. There we go. All right, so I will do, bin Magento module status, and I'll see what I get. Oh, cool. It's not finding me at all. App code, benmarks, brands, Etsy, module.xml. Did I? Well, let's see. Let's just blow away everything under here. Delete. We actually have a page on our documentation, which is devdocs.magento.com. We actually have a pretty good page that which goes through. Which goes through actually. And talks about the kinds of activities you're doing as a developer, and then what you might need to change out. Okay, cool. Actually, I will delete that too. The system might complain at me now, but all right. So basically, what I see is an entire list of modules that are enabled. And then I see list of disabled modules is none. And it's still picking up Benmark's brands, but I thought I... Oh! I know, yeah. So I did do something a little bit kind of hinky, because you're not probably not going to delete a module from, like I did. So under... App etc. Under App etc. config, there is Benmark's brands. Now, this file is actually should ideally be built just via the updated via the command line tool, but now we'll see here. Ah, so what the system has done is it's noticed, like, hey, we picked up that there's a module there, but it's not already added to this list. If we go back, and look at it. Still the same. It's basically like pristine, like the Benmarks thing isn't listed there. So now what I can do is I can say, okay, well, I want my module to actually work. So if I have controllers under my module, I want those routes to be routable. So what I'll do is I will call bin Magento module enable and just pass in the handle, Benmarks brands. And now I get some interesting output here. The following modules have been enabled. Make sure that the enable modules are properly registered. Run setup upgrade. So setup upgrade is what will go and check my module and see if it has some setup scripts to run, which at this point it doesn't. And I'm doing that intentionally. It clears the cache, generates, and wants me to rerun the compile command. I don't really need to do that right now because I don't have anything that needs compilation. One of the great benefits of Magento 2's sort of really big meta architecture is in AOP is that we've reintroduced to PHP the ability to say my code's compiling. All right. So next thing that we'll want to do, I think, that's actually interesting is to configure a front-end route. Right, so this is basically me going into the system and with a little bit of XML, one PHP class, and actually being able to go to a URL and have that URL execute my controller action. So I was very happy. I finally learned how to do curved arrows in Keynote. So I used them frequently. Sorry. So there are natively, there's a couple of routes that you're going to have that you regularly play with in Magento 2. They work a different way in the back end, in so-called admin HTML, than they do from the front end. I don't go into admin HTML here because I would need several more hours. But under that etc folder, I can drop in front end and then routes.xml. And routes.xml is, you can see, pretty slim. Again, this is something that could easily be configured with a skeleton app. So let's see what we have here. So standard. Stuff that's good to know, but stuff, again, you could totally copy another module's routes.xml from its front-end folder and just replace with your module stuff and work. So in this case here, again, another XSD defining what's right for this XML document. And then I have standard is actually what the router that handles front-end requests is called. Okay? I could go into that, but again, I don't have time. So essentially, if I'm a developer and I want to create a new front end URL fragment, in this case, I'm creating brands here. So in other words, in order to go to my Magento site, it is just mage2.dev. And I just cleared out a lot of stuff. Oh, yep. So, this is an interesting thing that's happened. If I were not in developer mode, I wouldn't get this error message. And you can imagine sort of forgetting to run the upgrade scripts for your module after you enable it. That could be a cause of confusion. You're like, why isn't it working? So that's, again, another just an example of why it's important to enable developer mode. So for mage2.dev, I'm getting this message like, hey, you need to run this upgrade script. Now before I do, I guess I'll go ahead and do that. And again, all it's going to do is it's going to look at basically all the registered modules and see if there is something, if there are scripts that need to be executed. So in fact, I think now I should be good to go. Let's see here. And this first request may take a little while because I deleted a lot of stuff. But you can see this is the sample theme that ships with Magento 2. It's all responsive and stuff. This is a slightly older. We have 2.1 is already out, and this is 2.0.4, which is an old version of 2.0. But you know, like, look at that. You can add to the cart. You can view products. You can add to your wish list. All sorts of stuff. So this is a working Magento instance. I can maybe demo the admin if I have time later. What I want to do is I want to actually, you can see here, well, actually here is, you know, push it messenger bag. But this is actually internally. This is probably, let's see if I can find out what. Yep, so this is product ID number 14. So Magento, of course, being an application for commerce websites, SEO is pretty important. So, you know, catalog, product, view, ID 14 is not a very good way to get your stuff seen by the search engines. But this is actually the internal URL that's getting translated from that nice SEO-friendly slugged URL. You can see I call that and I got the same page. So what we want to do, and what's happening internally. So this is the route that belongs to the catalog module. Makes sense. Now, and then when you see product, so this is probably a folder, and inside that folder is a view class. And that view class has an execute method, and that is what is handling this request, courtesy of the standard router. So what we want to do, or what we're trying to do here, is I'm like, you know, I have stuff I want to display under brands. And right now, if I go there, and this will take forever because of the state. Oh, no, it's actually came up. Oh, that's right, because I already generated this earlier. Now I've got a 404 page. So Magento actually has a way of handling an unhandleable route. And this is actually controlled by our CMS system. So this is actually rendering a CMS page. So front end, routes.xml, and I want to use the URL, that initial part of the URL, that initial part of the path is brands. It's for the front end, so that means I'm setting it up for the standard router. I've got it under the front end folder, and this route ID here is just arbitrary. It just needs to be unique, and I recommend to follow a convention because it comes into play later with layout XML. And we'll talk about that later. The module name, Ben Marks Brand. So what this does is this actually registers this URL fragment with this path, Ben Marks Brands Controller. Does that make sense? Right? So as essentially what you're doing is you've got, just like any web application, like a request comes in, it gets routed, you know, in this case to index.php, which bootstraps the app and kicks off the bootstrapping and does all this other stuff. And then execution, you can just watch it flow around to a front controller. The front controller finds out what routers exist in the system and then asks those routers, like, hey, can you do anything with this request? This is classic front controller pattern, right? Because we've registered this with the standard router, if the request comes in to /brands, that standard router is going to say, okay, well, all right, let me see. So that's that route, or that, you know, path resolves to this module, And so I'll look in the controller file there, or the controller folder, and see what I see. Now right now it doesn't see anything, because I have to create it. So I'll go here, and I will create a new file. And that file is going to be controller. And I'm going to do something special, index.php. Because essentially these URLs have have multiple parts, and by choosing index.php, I am able essentially for those three parts, if starting on the right, no, yeah, the right, if any part is missing, index is assumed. So essentially, to wit, this URL right here is actually internally getting mapped to brands/index/index. And that's not an uncommon convention for web apps either. So what I've done is I've created this. Now I have to actually create this class here. And so again, just to save time, I get to copy it because I made it already. Quite prodigious. All right, now some actual honest to goodness code. What are we doing here? What's going on? Again, that I am staying seated so well is really a miracle, because this is very exciting stuff. Got my namespace defined, and then I'm going to pull in some things from the application space. So I'm pulling in essentially the action class, right? We actually in Magento 2 would prefer to limit any direct inheritance. And theoretically, at some point, we're going to get to a place where it's just interfaces everywhere. We're just implementing interfaces so you can really be flexible. Now, that's architectural goals. Who knows? Fortunately, they're held back by a product team. But right now, this is one of the examples where we actually do have inheritance, right? And we just prefer interface implementation because that just makes it a little more flexible. But at some point, you can abstract yourself into oblivion. So we're inheriting this thing. Again, this is just this is a class that knows how to respond to requests. We have this context object. Now, this context object knows how to get things like the requests and the response objects. Basically, it's the appropriate kind of stuff that is necessary for responding to requests. And actually, I would say that the architecture team probably wishes they could get around that as well. And then I have the page factory. The view architecture in Magento 2 is a little bit bigger than in Magento 1. But essentially what happens is for any action controller, which is that's what this is, or controller action, it will have, you'll generally have two methods to implement. The constructor and the execute method. Now the execute method is what is called when that request brands/index/index is resolved to this file. This file is invoked, assuming it's been built correctly, and that execute method is called. And that execute method needs to return a page. So one of the unfortunate sort of full stops for me in this tutorial is not being able to delve into the page architecture. But you can also look elsewhere in the code, in the core code, and see how pages are returned. Like you can open up another modules controller folder and find those actions in there and look at what they're doing. I will say, though, that some of them actually still use kind of the old architecture, just not ideal. And that's another part of our developer experience story, is making sure that that the way one module does something is identical to the way that another module does it, right? Because the core should be a good reference for you. All right, so I've
I don't think I created my routes yet, so I'm going to do that as well. So front end. I'm going to spell it correctly, hopefully. So routes a route. So I've got my route content here. Gonna drop that in here. All right. So there's my route content. Again, this is arbitrary, but it's going to become important later. It's important for a couple reasons, only one of which we'll see in this little tutorial. And then I go, I don't have configuration. Will this do anything? I may need to run compilation. Ah, perfect. And by perfect, I mean it's widescreen. But it's a different kind of issue. See, I'm trying to get up there. This is actually what I expect, and I can prove it because I can go to my slides and hit play, and I can go. See, there's the code. Those of you following along at home, test your route. Okay, so I go to /brands, again, which is /brands/index/index. Why is the page blank? Well, because I haven't told the application what to put on that page. So if I just simply go in and add a little layout XML, then something magic will happen. Absolutely magical. So, a little more XML. But let me create that. So I need to have a view folder. View. Layout, and then inside layout, how do I know what file to create? So this is a little bit of convention over actual configuration, although I guess it involves configuration. Essentially, the application is going to look for some layout directives based on the current context. And this is something called a full action name. You don't really need to know this maybe until later, but what you do need to understand is how they're built. So actually, before I do that, if I'm trying to learn Magento, I could actually look at that. You recall earlier I went and looked at the product page, and I went to catalog/product/view. Well, if I go under the view folder for catalog, view front end layout, I can actually see that there is a catalog product view file there. And that is one of the layout files that gets pulled into scope simply because of how it's named. For Magento 2, it works similarly for Magento 1. So view layout file, we'll do front end slash. In my case, I need to use benmarks, brands, index, .xml. How do I know that, aside from having created this already? Well, the index hopefully is obvious, is apparent, right? It's my sort of that index path that is assumed when I went to /brands. And actually, I can go back there, go back here, and just demonstrate that actually works. And that's what we're getting here. Okay, so you can see it was kind of caching that meta title earlier. So the route, this route and the other route, functionally identical. But by creating this layout XML file, and copying it from here. All right. Actually, not this. This is just being read. It's pulling in the schema definition, but that it's fine. Even though it's red, I'm actually going to comment this out for now. So I have a layout file, and I have to do one more thing before that layout file can do its magic. So all I've done is I've actually said, hey, this page should have the one column layout, which is defined elsewhere. There's also like two column left, two column right, three column. And then I just have this body element here because I believe I have to, according to schema definition. And then I need to do one more thing. And that thing is I need to make sure that I either need to refresh the layout cache because all of those layout instructions, they get cached and assigned to each request. Or I can calculate them on the fly every time. And the way to do that is bin Magento cache disable layout. I think I've already done that, so it's going to tell me, hey, nothing's changing. But then I can go back and refresh here, and fingers crossed, nothing blows up. Excellent. Oh wait, let's see. Do that here. I'll do that here. Okay, I'll do that, and then we'll actually do it the we'll create the proper directory structure, which would be front end, then layout. That's right, folks, I'm a professional. Okay. Get rid of this extraneous hierarchy here. So now that I actually have, now that I have the actual proper structure in place, view, front end layout. There we go. Oops. Now, hopefully, we will see what we should see here. Look at that. That is a basic page, right? So this the reason I like to demonstrate this, even though like my module isn't doing anything yet, it's just serving this route. That's all it is. But it's my code executing. It gives me a good chance actually. Let's say things were kind of blowing up and I didn't know why. I could, if I wanted to, through the magic of XDebug, I can set a breakpoint here. And then I have a little browser helper here, this little guy. And all that's doing is it's like actually just passed in a session variable, causes a cookie to get set, if I remember correctly. That's funny, you use these little helpers and you forget how things actually work. But what's happening is, so XDebug is just a module that you plug into PHP. It's written by this great guy, Derek Retans. Derek is part of PHP internals. He's actually working at MongoDB now, but he's a great guy, great speaker. If you ever get a chance, I would just go to anything. And once you start using XDebug, for those of you who aren't, you will do what we did. Like when I was at Blue Acorn, we bought him like a $500 bottle of scotch because XDebug saved us I don't know how much time and money. So I've set a breakpoint here. And now if I execute this request again, pops open my IDE, because that module is actually just streaming out a bunch of information over a separate port, and my IDE is configured to listen to that port, and execution has been stopped right here, and you can see, look at what I get for my effort here. Well, actually for his effort. I get the call stack. I can see everything that's happening up to that point. Like, let's just say this is the first time I've been doing Magento 2 development. I've made it this far through a tutorial. I could see, like, whoa, Ben Marks brands controller index index interceptor. I didn't write that. The system created that for me on the fly. But the cool thing is I can actually go there. I could click on that, and I could see where execution went, like how it flowed through. You can step back through. You can also see the variables that exist. Like, I can look at the state of this, the object that's currently being executed here. This, I can see what is a result page factory. It's got, okay, it's object managers, got instance names, and you can really dig into an architecture with XDebug. It'll change your life. It's the way of the future. All right, so I can't stress enough, if you're going to do Magento development, or even if you're doing development with any framework, there's no reason to not use a step debugger. XDebug happens to be the one I know. There are one or two others out there. XDebug is great. It works out of the box for me now, pretty much most of the time. So this is essential. If I worked with somebody, if I hired a developer who was unable to get things done, or you know just wasn't growing over time, if he or she were not using any kind of step debugging in a Magento job, I would, you know, after trying to instruct them to do that, I would probably dismiss them. It's that important a tool to use. Okay, and by the way, and so once you do that, you can set multiple breakpoints and you can play, you can sort of step from point to point. You can also step into, so I could actually like go into this thing and see what's happening. I could step into the parent constructor and see, you know, I can go down, you know, step line by line and see how things change over time. Again, absolutely essential stuff. You should do it. In fact, although one caveat is that enabling XDebug will slow down your system because it is having to stream out all of this data. And if you start doing like cache grind, you can get a lot of real big volume of information, but you'll fill up a hard drive in like 12 seconds. So that is that. All right, I'm gonna close out a lot of this noise here. So routes. Don't need routes. Let's see. Don't need DI. Don't need my module my registration. All right. So you can see we've gotten this far. I could even, like, let's say I wanted to set the page title programmatically. And then I think it is page. Get config set. The set title. I want to say there's a title element here, and I could do, you know, brands list, and then return that page object. That's right. Oh, nope. Set title. Set page title? No. Well, another thing I can do here is I can actually go here to get config, pop open my IDE, get a list of methods. Again, if you've not seen anything like this before, really should get on board with it here. And I may not see may need to include show inherited here. Don't believe I don't remember this, but I know I have some code somewhere that, let's see if I open recent.
Let's see, I can look in here. There's another way for me to set a title that would be the way I would do it anyway, so I'll just do that. Let's see. All right. Sorry, and I like to put this over on the... Move to the right. There we go. Okay. Close that. Put that back up. All right. So here we are. Here's the title. I believe I forgot that. Anyway, sorry. Oh, I'm still... Oh, was it okay, config page layout? No. All right, I'll give up on that. But anyway, there is a way to set it programmatically in your controller. But again, the thing that I like to point out here is that where did all this come from? All I did was just say, hey, render a page. So this is actually, every module has the ability to define, you know, by default, what it wants to add. For example, the catalog module is adding this list of categories here, this menu. In the header, the page header, there's all sorts of data there. The appropriate metadata and so forth is being added. You know, this welcome message, which has come from configuration in the back end. The customer account area is rendering this bit right here. There's a search module that renders this. All of this stuff, there's a little CMS block here and some other stuff and newsletter. So all of this is actually being composed from XML instructions that are being provided to the system by various modules. And that's... that's sort of the end result of this. So the nice thing is now I can actually, you know, I can actually create, you know, I can start to create blocks and templates and start to add those to this existing standard page that the system renders. What the nice thing about that, of course, is that then my module has the ability to add to the system, add content to the system without having to redeclare all of this stuff for itself. All right. Let's see, what's next? Okay, so we did this. Why is the page blank? Because we hadn't done this. Time to add. Yeah. So again, and these slides will be available afterwards, and I'll throw the code up into a repository as well under my GitHub ID that you can check this stuff out, so you can mess around with it and hopefully suggest some improvements for the next time. I'll be doing this same tutorial at ZenCon in Vegas. That's for Vegas, not... We do our big conference in Vegas every year. I'm not much of a Vegas person. Any insight that you all have after the class would be much appreciated. Again, what we have to do is we have to... get title set. Get title set. All right, we'll just do that really fast. Cause then I feel this. Yeah.
Git config. Get title. I actually explicitly set it. This is a little. It's a little different from how it worked in Magento 1. And then double underscore is the ubiquitous translate function in PHP. I have no idea why. Now, and if I were setting up translation, that would be the proper thing to do, but again, don't have time. So I could do brands list. Awesome. And now if I refresh this, we'll see brands list. Setting up translation is actually pretty easy. It's just a little little configuration, and you drop in a CSE file, and you're good to go. So, all right. So you can see I'm able to affect an impact on this on this page content. Okay. Now that embarrassment is done, quickly to our ORM. Yes, Magento has its own ORM because reasons. The ORM, it's quite easy to work with. You just have some boilerplate set up. There's actually, there is, we do have a service layer architecture. So it is actually with a little bit of configuration and some very simple kind of boilerplate definitions, you can actually come up with, you actually get automatic like web API, just as sort of one of the benefits, and people can interact using SOAP or REST with that. I think we did away with XML RPC because it's awful. Right. The basics of our ORM. I'll start at the beginning. You have a business object, right? That's going to have some of the high level like application logic for that entity. And then you have that's the model. Then you have a resource model, and that is what is responsible for furnishing data. Retrieving data and handling the mapping of a request for data about an entity to its storage pattern. It's a kind of a funky way of saying it, I know, but in Magento, there are actually what we consider to be three different patterns for storing data. There's the simplest entity model where if an object has information, has a field of information that just maps to a field in the row of that entity's table. Right, so if something has a name, you would see a column in that table name. You also can have complex types where you actually have data that comes from two different tables, and in your resource model, you would just need to have just a little bit of PHP logic in there that says, "Hey, like, okay, map these two, pull these two things together," and then. We also have EAV. Who knows what EAV is? You do. Do you know it in a painful way, or do you know it in an academic way? Okay, cool. You know it in a painful way because you've done Magento development. EAV stands for Entity Attribute Value, and it is in some ways it is efficient from a can be normalized standpoint. It is woefully inefficient when it comes to a, oh my God, I have to join 14 tables together to actually get what essentially would be the array of data about an entity. Our ORM handles a lot of that. So if you're working with like a product actually has its data canonically stored in EAV, and we index that into a read table, so it's nice and flat and can be accessed quickly. But the nice thing is, if you're working with the product model, which has this EAV storage pattern, or if you're working with like this very simple brands model, which has simple storage, you know, just simple, straightforward table storage. These at the model level, you don't really know, or shouldn't know, the storage pattern. It's just a demonstration of sort of the classic point of having this kind of architecture, where you have the resource model that just says, okay, I know how to take this information that you're trying to save, or I know how to load this information that you're trying to get. Because I know about the I know and care about the storage pattern. Models don't care at all. So your model here is this one is super super simple because all it has is a name. But there's just some boilerplate that you have to do in order to set it up. So essentially, what you do is we have this kind of relationship where models need to know what their resource model is because they have the CRUD operation. And the CRUD operation would be, you know, read, update, and delete, right? Create, read, update, and delete. In Magento, that maps to load, which is read. Read matches to load. Create and update are just mapped to save. And delete is delete. So that's, I could call brand... save and pass in the appropriate data, and that would go into the resource model, and then the resource model would make sure that gets either saved into storage or update the appropriate record. So that's probably the most important thing here, right? And down here, I'm actually just in Magento. There is this magic getters and setters, right? So if a column exists in a table for a simple entity, you can just simply load that entity and call get whatever that column name is, and it just works. We're trying to shy away from that or not do that in Magento 2. We want people to be explicit about things, just to eliminate some of the magic. So the model needs to know about its resource model. The resource model, you'll notice these all inherit from a particular abstract class, and that this is actually going to go away in Magento 2. It hasn't yet. But over time, the plan is to actually make those also depend on interfaces. So the conventions are
you already know how to do this.
Stop. Okay. The conventions are. For how this is done is under the model folder would be your model class definition. Then under a model resource model folder, your class definition. And all it needs to do is it needs to be told what the table name is. In this case, I've chosen Ben Marks Brands, just as kind of a namespacing convention. And it needs to know the primary key. And then you have a collection. And the collection is used to model groups of getting a record set and being able to loop over it.
Oh, that did not go well at all.
Let's see. All right. So, what a collection needs to know is it actually needs to know the resource model to use in order to retrieve the data, because everything, all that data retrieval goes to the resource model. And it also needs to know for each row, resulting row, which model to use. So that's why it has to know those two things. And that is the extent of the simplest implementation of Magento's ORM, right? Model, resource model, collection. And you could copy these three definitions and just change things as appropriate for whatever your model name is, and it'll work. And then the only thing you'll have to do after that is to actually install the table, to actually create that schema. And by convention, that exists under setup install schema. Now there's also install data. There's also update schema, update data. So basically you have scripts which are intended to affect table schema, and you have scripts which are intended to affect changes in data. So setup, the install schema, what this does is, you'll remember a moment ago, I was doing something. What was I doing? A moment ago, when I enabled the module, I did it by setup upgrade, right? And that actually just looked at my module configuration and saw the setup version 0.0.1. Now what that did, let's see, what that did here is, oh, that's right, I can't clear it here. That's gonna not work. I just totally threw in a Windows command. If I were to, select here from setup module, so there's a table inside the Magento database that is essentially the registration that, like, hey, if you've installed a setup script, if you've actually tried to execute setup scripts for a module, and what version. So if I select this record, what I get is in setup module. So if I just select star from setup module, I get a whole list of all the modules inside Magento, plus mine. So you can see it's a very simple table. Just has the module handle and the schema version and the data version. And by the way, you can always tell if something has gone wrong with your setup scripts by the data version being different from the schema version. That just means something broke. Those two should actually always be even or equal. I could actually, I could create an upgrade, an update script for my module, and then run setup upgrade and get that to and increment the module version in my configuration. But I'm just actively developing. I haven't released my module yet. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to execute. I'm going to do what you have to do often when you're creating setup scripts. And I'm going to delete that record from setup module. So essentially, as far as the system is concerned, it hasn't run any update scripts for my module yet, or setup scripts. Okay, so that's done. So according to the system now, my module hasn't been installed. And in fact, it notices that by looking, basically saying, like, hey, in your configuration here, you said this module, this file system for this module, it's at version 0.0.1, but it didn't find that in the database. So then all I have to do is run bin Magento, setup upgrade. Oh, Of course, it'd probably help if I put the actual. It's not reading my presentation, so let me do that again. Let me copy the file system from here. See, we'll actually copy. I think I can do this both. Like that, paste that over here. Yep. So there's my class hierarchy for the model layer, as well as my setup script, just called install schema. And you can see it's a very simple thing. Magento has a DDL, data definition library. So it's just taking generic table description and theoretically able to map that to different kinds of storage. In practice, I believe we're still only running on MySQL and its equivalents, like MariaDB. All right, so in the install here, creating a table as appropriate for whatever the backend type is, and which again, MySQL, NODB, adding the primary column here. Actually, vendor ID, that's copy paste there. That should be brands ID. There we go. And yeah, and then also adding another column, just a simple text column for the name. And then if I run setup upgrade again, now I should be able to describe the table that I created, Ben Marks Brands, and there it is. Good stuff. Let's see, I'll go ahead and copy that because I bet that's wrong on the other slide. Okay. All right. So, refresh here. I should just see the same page again. Of course, I haven't done anything to say, hey, display a list of things. Okay. Go back to my presentation here. You can see, again, so this just walks through what I was doing before, so I just walked through the decision. I haven't released my module yet, so I can delete that thing. If I had released my module, I would have to publish an update script for this, as opposed to an install script. And you can see the next step here, but I'm gonna actually delete that real fast. Hey-o. Totally professional time here. Got a little line there. There we go. Okay. And that's how it's done in the big leagues. All right. So again, just as a troubleshooting note, and I did want to demonstrate that process of actually going into the database and deleting the record to essentially reset the system. So the system just says, hey, there's a discrepancy. I have files for this module, and it says those files say it's at this version, but then when I look at the data, I don't see it, which tells me that you haven't run those scripts yet. So the application considers that to be an invalid state. Basically, the file system is not in sync with what the database schema are. So now, if we were trying to render a list, and this timing is actually working out miraculously well. If we're trying to render a list of things here, well, we just create a block. We need to add that block reference to layout XML and refresh, just to try and see if it has an effect. And as it so happens, I have a block created. Actually, I think I was planning on getting this far. There we go. So I've got this brand list block here, and we actually too need to talk about this a little bit, because this is where a little bit of Magento magic happens, if you're doing it right. So under brands, I'm going to create a new file, and by convention, in the block folder, brands list. our brand list. Need to refactor here. Rename is called refactoring in the PHP Storm. So brand list is it's a simple block, right? It's inheriting from the template object. And the template object just essentially is a class that knows how to be rendered. Again, this direct inheritance will probably go away in some future version of Magento 2, but for right now, this is what we're using. But let's look at what's happening here. So we've got I'm saying, hey, you know, use my collection object, and then also use a collection factory. The hell's a collection factory? I haven't created a collection factory. In Magento 2, anything like this that ends in factory, well, that's where we get some of the famous Magento magic, right? So the application is going to actually build this, through compilation, is going to build this for us. It's actually, and this just goes into, this is part of the AOP machinery, the aspect-oriented programming machinery of Magento 2. And this essentially following this pattern. I mean, I could just use a collection. Pretty sure I believe I can use a collection class directly. But by following this pattern, I actually avail myself of some of the customizability of the system. But this does mean I have to compile stuff. So what that means here is I actually have to run. Bin Magento, setup di compile. And so this is going to then walk through a process of calculating all of the dependency injection and you know, looking at this block has basically looking at all the class definitions and figuring out what needs to be built, and this also includes this collection factory for this object. So while that's running, and we'll fingers crossed, this takes a little while. The speed of that is also something that we're working on as part of our developer improvements. But while that is running, we'll go ahead and create the template. That I'm going to use in concert with this class. Templates. And I think, what is that? A brand list.phtml. And if I go over to here, I believe I already have that. Templates, brand list. Yeah, this is going to be pretty simple here. Brands, get name. That's still compiling. I'm down to 11%. All right. So the idea is that I'm gonna add an instruction to my layout file that says, "Hey, oh, sorry, I'm in the wrong place. Load up in the content area." So there is, you have to understand that actually as part of this page definition, there is a content block, and that is essentially, that's just a content container, and that content container is just waiting to be have blocks assigned to it, and then those blocks will be rendered. So what I'm doing is I'm assigning my brand list block here through this directive. So I'm saying in that content container, load up this class instance, use this brand list template, and that'll resolve relative to here. And away we go. We'll see where we are in the compilation process. This, you can see it takes a little while. I wasn't kidding. We've really, with Magento 2, we have, like, you know the joke, like, my code's compiling, like, when the boss walks by and sees you playing Pokemon or whatever, yeah, well, my code's compiling. Like, literally, PHP developers can say that again when they're doing Magento 2. Again, we really are actually trying to, this is slow. We really want this to be much faster. Yeah. So once this is done, though, I'll be able to refresh and hopefully it'll work here. Actually, I don't think I tested the view to see if it renders. But it's very simple. What, in theory, if it's working right, what's happening is that layout instruction gets executed. It will, again, it'll instantiate this class. This class will include this template because it's part of a template block, and the template block will receive the data. So it's going to execute this get brands and brand get name. And I could even actually, if I wanted to include a type hint here, I could do a little at var notation, brand is Ben Marks, brands, and then I can actually do, there we go. Model brand, there we go. All right, and then I actually should probably close that out. There we go. So you can see once I did that, this no longer was showing an error, or showing like, hey, I have no idea what this function is. And maybe I'll just wrap this all in a div. So this is an example. This is a very simple example of PHTML. Again, you could, it's literally just a mixture of PHP and HTML. One of the really cool things about Magento being being so decoupled from the framework is you can very easily, and someone actually did it on a flight after one of our beta forums. Literally, they were flying back to Australia from the States and just banged out a twig template parser for Magento 2, and then it was just like one line of DIXML to just say, hey, use this template processor rather than the PHTML template processor. Of course, then you have to create all of the templates in Twig, but just kind of proves the flexibility of the system. All right, that is done. We will see the effect here. That, oh, I don't actually have any brands in my application. But if I did, oh God, what is the insert into? What the hell's the syntax? Insert into Benmark's brands. Value, thank you. I was like, wait a minute, I'm drawing a blank here. Values, let's see. Do one foo. All right. Actually, we'll add a couple here. Two bar. Oops, that didn't go so well. Insert into the next brand's values. That didn't work. Okay. The danger of using, if you use a Mac, you get this great program. There it is. Hey. Whew, hands off. Done. Perfect. It works. Oh, of course. I'm already setting the title elsewhere. I should remove that from my template. And I wasn't translating it either. So that's a bad boy. Okay. That doesn't seem right. then it just mysteriously goes away. That's great. It gives you a lot of confidence in, you know, working with them too. There it is. All right. So that's the system. And my Mac's running out of power. This is cavalier. All right. Resources. You should know some great resources. And I actually, as I was sitting down, was like, holy crap, I didn't write any resources. So we'll add them right now. You should go see alanstorm.com. Absolutely. He is a programmer's programmer. He digs into not just Magento, like when Laravel 5 comes out, he went in and he looks at it basically like he is taking over as an architect. Does some resources there. We've got alankent.me. Alan Kent is our brilliant chief architect. Came to us from the search team at eBay. Great guy, Australian, super friendly, very effective. He's got, his blog is full of Magento stuff. We also have devdocs.magento.com. That is our documentation. And I would say if you are interested in VMs, go to get the Mage 2 Vagrant on GitHub. There we go. Mage 2 Vagrant on GitHub. And let's see, what else do we have? We have Mage Inferno. Lots of Mage stuff in the Magento world on Docker. Those are just a few of the resources. There are so many resources out there. There's actually a community curated list of resources out there. If you go to, what is that list? GitHub.com. Was it Aileron 72? Nope, I forget his name. We can go to Ben Marks, where you will be able to find this under Ben Marks. There's that clever guy just eating a bunch of fondue in Switzerland. If we go, I have this very outdated Magento resources thing here. So there's a lot of stuff, but some of this is actually based on Magento 1. And I know if there are a couple people here, no, who's forked this? Oh, I should update that too. Anyway, the guy that actually made these shirts. So this is me on this shirt. I don't make shirts of me. The community actually did this. This was just a joke. I just pointed at someone's camera once, and then there was always this big problem with Magento 1 about people editing the core, right, to do stuff when they didn't need to. And so someone actually just made a meme, and so I became a meme. It's, don't edit the core. Oh, the cool thing is now with Magento 2, because it's on GitHub, it's sort of like, don't edit the core unless you submit a pull request. That's what we want. So thank you all very much. I hope it was informative. I think I'll try and do better next time about telling people to getting people, you know, a working installation. Because you really probably could have followed along with this okay today. It's just a matter of getting set up. So there is that. I have stickers. I gave out some stickers earlier. I have more if you're into stickers. I am contractually obliged to stick all the stickers here. it's like it's in my work contract. But yeah, I have more. Always, if you have any questions, you've got my contact information. I'm actually going to remember to show that slide here to close things out. So there's some resources. Here we go. Please absolutely reach out to me if you have any questions, even if it's hey, how do I get going? Or I'm stuck on this thing. It's literally my job to help. You can also go, there is a Magento focused Stack Exchange site. It's one of the highest traffic sites on Stack Exchange, which I don't know we should brag about, but it's a great resource. It's a great community of people. One of the guys on there, he's on there so much, they made a website for him. ismariusawake.com, although I think it's offline right now. But literally, you just looked at the Stack API to see if he was posting, because he's always up posting. That's it. That's all I got. Thank you very much.